My name is Jonathan Baker. I am the director of Inconceivable. I'm also the producer and the co-star. I've rewritten this script twice with the writer Chloe King, and we're doing this for Lionsgate. Lionsgate is a great studio, and they have a deal with Grindstone, who originally came to me through EFO, which is the next credit, and asked me to do movies with them. And I didn't want to do shoot 'em ups. I wanted to do a dramatic movie, and I wanted to do a movie with women in it. And so that's how Inconceivable kind of found its way to me. Here we are, JB Entertainment. It was supposed to be Jonathan Baker, Baker Entertainment Group, as you see. But because we did end credits, everybody could not have proper names at the front, which was really interesting because it meant a lot to me to put my name up there. Branding's everything. This is the beginning of the movie. It's up in the night of the night's eye, looking down on small town USA. And I found it to be interesting to shoot with drones and to kind of find our way into this household that it's supposed to be Christmas. And I was told 3 days before that we were not going to do Christmas. I was kind of bamboozled. So I had to think really, really quickly. So I made it Thanksgiving. It was a big deal to me. Here's Nikki Whelan. She's a great actress. She came in and told me what she wanted, and I thought about it, and I watched her, and we worked together for weeks and weeks to develop this character. And she really hit it out of the park, you know, as you'll see. She was a true delight to work for. And what's interesting is that she specializes in comedy. So I had my doubts whether she could really go deep. And, you know, she really did a fantastic job.
Shh. It's gonna be...
So she's supposed to be an abused woman right now. And she's coming down, and there is her husband. And that's Eli. He acted as my second unit director at times, flying the drones. And he was the stunt coordinator, and had an amazing time working with him. He, you know, and I got lucky. He was a great actor. And so that's why I put him in as Mr. Reynolds.
What are you doing? Lisa,
just please let us go.
No.
As you can see, she's supposed to be abused by the husband and is supposed to be leaving. And we find out later on that that's not the case. That, you know, he's really trying to get the baby. That's why he says Maddie right here. And what we find out is that she's kidnapping the baby. And obviously, you know, for anybody who has not watched this movie before, that's, you know, information you shouldn't be told. So, Inconceivable, great name. Loved to do this movie because it was about women, for women, had women's topic, and Nick Cage came in because he wanted to support women in film. And, you know, it took a very strong actor to take a third position to Nikki Whelan and Gina Gershon and Faye Dunaway. And Nick is a fabulous actor. Came in prepared, ready, knew his character, knew everybody else's character. And you know, I was the only other actor with him and Jimmy Van Patten in the whole film. So, you know, it was nice to have another guy on the set at times. And he was a true and consummate professional. And he taught me a lot about who I am as a director and as an actor by the time that I spent with him. And there's Gina Gershon. She, you know, she was one of my first picks, and the studio had their doubts. They wanted Claire Fluani. They came up with names on names and names, and I said, no, I really wanted Gina because of her method acting and because she was a New Yorker, because she had that look of Gina Gershon. And you see Harlow, who is her child, I had picked her out way before I picked Gina out because I thought she was a find, and she's a great actress, a great little actress. And I saw her, and I had her read for the part, and she did such a great job that I kept her on hold. And again, the studio didn't want to bring her to Cincinnati, but eventually they saw the value in her, and they brought her.
They don't get to see their kids as often, and they wanted more than that, you know? Thank God I'm not a single father.
I thought that Nick and Gina had a lot of chemistry together, at least in my mind, and so it did pay off. So their family unit, pretty, you know, pretty realistic. So I'm pretty proud of myself because they never, ever came into a room together. And they're all different types of acting techniques. And so where we are right now is in Cincinnati, Ohio. And that, it used to be the Hamptons. And so I went to the Hamptons, and this movie was supposed to be there. The last moment, again, the studio and the production company told me I could not shoot there. It was too expensive, and the tax credits weren't enough. So I decided, you know, that I needed to work with what I had. And so they tried to shoot this in the South, and I said I refused to do it. And basically, I saw them shooting another movie up here, and I was like, I'll take it. Let's go to Cincinnati. And it was still going to look like the Hamptons. And so the redhead is Sienna Soho. She is my child. So her and Harlow I put into school for 3 months to prepare for this movie. They're both 4 years old here. And I found it to be enlightening. And everyone kept saying, but are you going to be able to direct your own kid? Are you going to be able to, you know, separate yourself? Are you going to, you know, there's professionalism, you know, hold everybody accountable, including kids.
Yes, I've heard about you too.
So I'm thinking threesome play date, Angie's house, you guys bring the kids.
Natalie Eva Marie. She is a WWF wrestler, and she had red hair, and she came in and she read for me, and I loved what she did so much. And my first question was, will you dye your hair black? Well, she thought about it. She said yes, and then she never went back. She literally never went back to red. And she is a fabulous newcomer. This is her first acting job, and as you see, she's very comfortable with the girls.
Yeah. She was first my trainer, and then we became pals.
Locations were a big, big thing to me. I cared so much about big breath locations, and nobody really felt that way except for me. But as you can see, this journey looks great lensed. And the hospital, it was the Reynolds house and this Morgan house right here.
So I figured starting a Mommy and Me business seemed the best way to infuse the two.
Get them while they're young. That's her motto.
The three of the girls, Nikki, Eva, and Gina, really got along really well. They had instant chemistry. And at the beginning of the movie, I asked for one thing, a table read, and nobody wanted to give me the table read. And I kind of begged for it, and they kept saying, why do you want a table read? Nobody does that anymore. Because I had such limited time to shoot this movie. It had started at 21 days, and every time I made a decision or every time I showed up to work, a day would be taken away from me. And so I don't know why it was done, but I knew that if I was making mistakes on set, or if the actors had choices that they wanted to make, or delete that I was going to be in trouble and I would definitely have not made my days. I would have fallen behind. So I made it very apparent very quickly that we needed a table read and everybody's character needed to be worked out. It wasn't for everybody to act what was going on and for me to correct them. It was for them to get out every single point that they needed to get out so that I could know that they're good with their character. And so that happened. It took 8 to 10 hours in a room, and it was the best 8 to 10 hours because when we got to the set, we had less things to work out. And I was shooting the first week 14 pages a day, which is unheard of. Normally, you shoot 3 pages a day. The next week I was shooting 9 pages a day. You know, again, it's 2 to 3 pages a day for a film. And then the third week I was down to 5 pages a day, which is like a vacation. But it was intense, nerve-wracking.
Here it is. Wow.
This is the beginning of Sienna character. So she plays Nikki's daughter. And she did a great job. So proud of her. I mean, whether she's my child or not, she just has a character arc. You can actually see her go from this scraggly kid to actually belonging to a family by the end. And she got it. I mean, she had one day where she melted down, and the rest of it, she was very observant and very present. And her and Harlow, which is present right here, got along fabulously, and they were troopers. I was made many times to cut the children out in certain areas because of the Bond company, and you know, I fought for what I believed, and I let go of what I needed to, and I thought the kids were an intricate part of this movie, and if they didn't do their job, this movie would not succeed on any level.
Okay, I'm gonna, let's go over here.
Katie, what's the matter?
I hate having my picture taken.
Aw. But you're so gorgeous.
Again, Nikki Whelan and Gina Gershon and Eva Marie, the instant chemistry. Gina's technique, is amazing. She really, again, she came prepared and, all right. So there's me. It's my first scene. I'm Barry. And I'm Nick Cage's best friend. Faye Dunaway, who is a consummate professional. Here she is. You know, this is her first scene. I love Faye. I loved her old movies. I love her new movies. And I loved her working with me. And we worked for a long time to get the character right and to get the backstory right, and she would call me, and I just respected her so much. Everyone would ask me, you know, why am I acting in the film? Well, because as a first-time director, I wanted the respect of the actors, and I felt the only way to do it was cellularly. I wanted the actors to respect me as an actor, and then as a director, because that's what they. That's what they understood. So they could come to me and talk to me from that level.
I'll drink to that.
Yeah. What about me?
You too, Maddie.
Faye Dunaway. One of the most interesting parts of her journey here was a couple of days before we started shooting, I got a call that told me that she broke her leg. And did I want to replace her? And I didn't want to replace her. And, you know, how would I feel if she was using a cane or if she was in a wheelchair? And I just was like, no, I'm not going to do that. No. And so I said, give me 24 hours and I will rewrite, you know, do a director's rewrite on this entire character. And so I did. So what you will see is that every single scene she's sitting down, and what you'll see is it's covered, and you'll never realize how much pain she's in, but she's in excruciating amount of pain, consummate professional, have so much respect for her, and I feel privileged to have worked with her. Here we are where Katie first gets to see the two children together, And you know, these are her children. I mean, we find out that she has gone sterile in college by delivering these two eggs who are inseminated into another person's womb. And this is the first time she sees her children together. She's kidnapped one, and she came to see how the other is doing. And I think that she's in, her character's in shock.
Please tell me that your mother doesn't have to come on the 4th as well.
We actually, you know, people made fun of me on the set, but I'd be like, look, you know, I want to see a slice of life, and that's what you're getting right here. I wanna feel that the audience can relate to some basic stuff before Katie reacts in any way, shape, or form to things that are happening, you know.
I think there's some sort of disconnect there.
Oh my God.
Are you okay?
Oh my God, you're trembling.
We're made to be brought in and out of consciousness by the journey of Katie. And sweet and innocent, and then we discover her psychosis. Some of it is made up in her own head, and some of it is the story that unfolds. But the audience is supposed to take this journey of when you let somebody in your house, you know, who are you letting in your house? And, you know, at some point she was had some scenes with Nick where it kind of looks like she's really sleeping with him. And, you know, I went light on all of that because this is a women's film for women about women. And I didn't want to make it exploitation. And so I went very gentle, very less is more. And you'll see as we unfold with their character how, you know, how I did it and at least what I was trying to protect. Because I believe that the audience for this film are the people that are actually identifying with what's going on here, and that the men are kind of identifying with Nick, which is kind of, hey, I'm the man of my family, and you know, I'm successful. I get to have fun, and I want a family, and you know, I kind of want it on my terms. But all of this other drama is going on, and he's always trying to support his wife, but you know, when you're outnumbered by women, you know, a lot goes on, and that's what I tried to show in that slice of life.
I'm just sitting here rambling to you. I'm so embarrassed.
No. Don't be embarrassed. I understand.
So this next scene coming up is the definition of the movie, you know, about babies and why everybody's there. But they're telling a secret, but they're not telling the truth about the secrets. And they're trying to tell their truth to each other. And that's what human nature is. You tell lies in the open. And that's what they're basically doing. They're telling lies to themselves right now. And right after this, you're going to see, there's only one scene in the movie where Katie, you see where Katie lives. And that's the scene directly after this. And you know, because we're talking about, you know, why they're runaways. And you're kind of justifying, you know, why they haven't been caught, right? Because at the beginning, you saw her with dark hair. Now you see her with blonde hair. She looks like an abused woman. You don't realize that that's all a charade until later on. But she really pulls it off well. Her core character, Nikki, really makes you believe that she's likable. And that's what I tried to go for. That was what's important to me. Anything else would have been overdone.
I haven't, and I won't. Well, I think you're amazing. And an awesome mom.
Oh.
Cora is lucky.
Yeah. I love Gina. She's just got so much strength, and her acting is always so spot on. She was my first pick. I just enjoy her as an actress, and I think she's underrated, and I think that people should, you know, be celebrating her. Here, this is the famous motel scene that I had problems shooting the outside on because we ran out of days, and so I had a compromise. again, the you see the contact lenses, the brown and the blue eye have a lot to do with this movie in terms of the sociopathic personality, you know, that I tried to subliminally show to the audience, you know, of who is Tara and who is Katie. And there's Maddie as a baby. Really interesting that you can see, this is her. She had just come from downstairs stabbing Mr. Reynolds. And you still don't realize, you still think it's the wife right now. You think that this, that she just killed her husband. And she really killed a stranger. Hardest part of the whole movie for me was shooting this gazebo, because we had to cut out one other scene, which is the introduction to Katie. So instead of her coming up and shaking hands at the beginning and shooting pictures, she actually comes into this scene, it didn't work for whatever reason. So it was the only scene out of the movie that I cut, and this was the partner to that. So Gina's obviously having a miscarriage, and her best friend is Eva, Natalie, and she was her doula. Interesting part of her character was that originally she was a doula, and I changed it because I wanted her to play to her strengths, which was, that's why I made her the triathlon that she is. You know, I thought that, you know, she doesn't really look like a doula, so you know, I just thought, well, let's kind of play to her strengths.
We won't have the family that we wanted, that we said we would, what you wanted.
Honey, please stop worrying about me. You're the one that keeps going through hell.
No, but I just want what you want. You know, the big family.
So Nick and Gina, they were amazing. They've actually been in other movies together, Face Off, if you remember that. And they knew each other from high school, from what I was told. So I thought that was really interesting. I just happened to pick them out because I thought they would look well together. And I thought that they had interesting acting techniques that I thought would work on film. Because movies are 50% of casting. And you have to go with your actors. You have to believe that who you picked is the right thing. If you made that mistake, when they hit the set, the movie's done. There's nothing you can do. So movie making is preparation. How do you prep? How do you, you know, your vision is about seeing it through your mind's eye and then compromising the reality that you're in to bleed it together.
Cora, Maddie, get changed and I'll meet you by the pool, okay?
Okay, Daddy.
Hey, guys. I have a little announcement to make.
So this scene was supposed to be done on a beach in the Hamptons. And so I had it envisioned to be so different. But the walk was the same and the execution was close to the same.
To a job there. And I really need to get out of that.
This is when she gets invited to kind of be a nanny in the household, because Gina's a little lonely, and the kids are so close, and this is the beginning of trouble. I mean, but nobody knows it. But you can look at Nikki's face right here. She's not going to accept it until Gina says she's going back to work, and that's the beginning of the psychotic rabbit hole for Katie.
I'm not abandoning her.
See?
I'm going to work, you know, part-time. I'm a doctor. You know, it's what I do. It's what we've talked about.
We could have gone over the top with this, but we decided to go less is more again. Slice of life.
Right. Come on, she'd be devastated if you left. You can't go.
No, you've convinced me. I'll stay.
She's burning up on the inside thinking, you know, you've convinced me. She's looking and thinking to myself, okay, and then Nick and Faye, great mother and son.
Brian,
again,
are you sure
she was in so much pain.
Angela's still getting over the miscarriage, and Katie might be nothing more than a crutch. Angela shouldn't be making big decisions.
She thinks it'll help with her recovery.
Which one?
God, you can be abrasive.
Nick did a great job with with Faye, and he knew that she was in a lot of pain.
2 years, not so much as an Advil. And if having her best friend here helping us gives her some comfort.
One big happy family. And I'm my character, Barry. I'm a little jealous that she got the guest house, and I've known them for all these years. And, you know, I've traveled the world with Nick and done all these things. And, you know, as you see coming up, I'm kind of, what's really going on here? Why is she moving in? And so here I am, me and Nick kind of having this conversation about fireworks and everything. And then Faye Dunaway came in.
We've been doing this for 8 years.
Eight years. You know, look, I really enjoyed being in the middle of them. I like the banter. And I cut myself out of a couple of scenes because it didn't support the film. So I was in originally 8 scenes, maybe 9, and I think I wound up with 7 that are pretty good throughout the whole movie. But I wanted to be supportive, and I wanted Nick and I to really be the anchor against these women. And that's one of the reasons why I also wanted to direct the film, because I believe that I would be a good director for these characters. I would be able to help them by being an actor inside the film, and more important, by being a producer, I could fight for the things that were right. So, you know, I'm different than most directors, and that I really want a 360-degree experience. So that after the miscarriage, and this is after the 4th of July dinner, everybody's gone home and settled in, and you know, obviously, the happy couple are having a moment of clarity of what they really want or don't want. And it's not just about sex right now. It's really about how do you give to your partner when you've got nothing in the tank. And that's where the movie takes off again. And our character is now going to get into some trouble. And or it seems like he's going to get into some trouble. I didn't want to push it too far. I didn't want it to be a movie about a nanny invading and having sex with the family. I wanted it to hold the line. But here's the point where I decided to give the audience a little taste. So first of all, that water is so cold. They wouldn't heat it. I don't know why they wouldn't heat it. So she had one take to do this. I asked her to do it twice. She could not do it because it was so cold on the second time. She said, that's it. But she gave it to us, and look at her face. Not a flinch. You can tell that it's cold, but it's more eerie than anything. And the brown and the blue eye, I mean, it was just supposed to be, is he sleeping with her or is he not sleeping with her? Right. Is that the beginning of it? Is something really going on here? And then you have the cute, you know, nanny kind of doing the mural for the wall. And Gina's character getting ready to go to work for the first time. And you can see, Nikki. Or Katie getting so mad that she just gave her a dig, and she doesn't know what to make out of it. But really, at the end of the day, Nikki's character is just going crazy at this point, and she's trying to figure out, what she's going to do, to protect her children, but nobody knows it's her children. Birdie. The black nurse right here. I found her in Cincinnati. I loved her. She had a great smile and great presence. And hiring extras is just as important, and a lot of directors don't do it. They just, you know, bring in a casting person and everybody just kind of shows up. They don't really pick or have a big choice. I made sure to have a big choice. Made sure that my hand was in every single thing that you see in this movie. Nothing happened without me or my brain registering it. So this is The Wishful Life, basically looking at Gina's life. And, you know, there's a girl from the other side of the tracks who went sterile in college, who basically is an artist who went and to check up on her first child and then lost her cookies and took the child and then came here to see about the other child. There's me and Faye. You know, it just says to show part of the family, the 8 years, you know, and how close I am with the family, but yet I'm not living in the guest house. So kind of interesting. Interesting, all the artwork you're about to see as she comes around the corner, they're all spread out in the art. So not that, but the other artwork here. Jacob is a famous artist in Sweden, and this artwork is all over the house. It comes from my hotel, the Maidstone in East Hampton, where we have a permanent collection. So I shipped it all out to this house, all my artwork. So we shipped boxes and boxes and boxes so that I could, you know, really feel the flavor of you know, modern art and photography and pop art and pop culture, and but still be sophisticated. So here's Gina coming in, and she's coming back from work, and remember, Nikki was bored, so she decided that she was going to invite her friend over, and not expecting Gina for another couple of hours. Gina's looking for Brian because she sees his car, and he's out on the motorcycle. So interesting scene here. The music was supposed to be Adele. It was so expensive. And Avicii. It was about $100,000 for this song. So I had my friend put this song together, and I really thought it fit. But no, that's not Brian, and we don't know who that is, and I'm not going to really tell you right now, but you probably already know. But the thing about this scene is that everybody wanted more but me. So that's the end of the scene. Everybody wanted to show the tits and the ass and the kissing and the exploitation of the scene, and I didn't. And at some point, when I got what I wanted, I basically stopped the entire production and closed the set down, knowing that I didn't have final cut and knowing that I didn't want it to be an exploitation and knowing that this was a female audience, female driven and female audience, that I just wanted to go light. And so it was a bit of an experience to I'm probably the only person to say they don't want more, they want less. Here's Faye again. Oh. Again, sitting down. All these scenes were blocked differently. All of them. So we did not reveal who the person was, but we know it wasn't Brian because we saw the leg. We saw that it was a smooth leg. And, you know, here we're acknowledging that it was a woman. And is Katie bi? Probably. Is she sleeping with Brian? Maybe. Is she, you know, is she, you know, having it like still likable? Yes, which is what I find to be really interesting.
Yeah, anything serious? Oh, no. Yeah, no, I don't have that luxury after my ex.
She's just a psycho, psychopath. I mean, that's really, you know, we're digging down into a person who can lie on top of lie on top of lie and be likable. That is your true psychopath. So we are, you know, that's the last moment that they're really that they're really friends, and again we switch gears again, and we're wondering who was the woman. And Gina's like, oh, it wasn't Brian on. I didn't give it to him the last couple of times. I'm going to lose my husband if I don't sleep with him. So, you know, she basically goes back and tries to seduce him. And, you know, he's kind of like, oh, you're back. Where have you been? So, you know, it is what it is. You still need to cover the intimacy. Then you have Natalie, and we reveal here that they are together. And we tried to set that up. Will you walk me out? Earlier on in the film, and there was a big discussion about revealing her in the sex scene and making it go further, or doing it less and revealing it here. The writer wanted it to be revealed there, and I wanted it to be revealed here. So I'm not sure how you guys feel, but whoever's watching this, you can always send me an email and tell me, you know, if you thought I made the right decision, or if you thought that it should have been more in the bedroom and kind of reveal her there.
And what is it?
Okay. Angela wants to tell you herself.
This is the scene. This is it. This is where Katie snaps. Again, I played it less than more, because if you play it more than more, what happens through this is that the audience doesn't believe it, or they get numb. And the realism disappears, and then you've just got this overdramatic thriller suspense movie, and we've seen those a million times. So I've always wanted to make movies that always had a, you know, fall on the side of real, so that we can follow the journey, and my career will never get looped into thriller or just, you know, some horror suspense movie, which is just not who I am.
But who's counting? Hey, are you okay with this?
Yeah, no.
See the switch?
It's not my business.
Yep.
Or my body.
You can see the switch right here in her reaction. I mean, these are her children that we're talking about. And if you see the pendant around her neck, you know, that gets revealed pretty soon. Okay, so here we go. She goes into the water, and just Katie's just, she's Tara, Katie. You can just see that she's going crazy. I didn't have a transition scene, so I used the water because it was raining that day and we got washed out. So I only had so much to work with. So now she shows up an hour later, and it's supposed to be her bathing suit, but she's crying, and the production forgot the fake tears, so she's supposed to be hysterical right now, and so I had to make her more cold, and I had to, you use what you have, but her emotional journey at this point to kind of feel that these are my children, she's not going to let them go. I mean, she's come to terms with who she's murdering and why, and she's always telling the truth before she murders.
Donor.
I'm the donor.
What?
She's telling the
truth.
They're
my eggs. They're my babies.
No, that's impossible.
Cora's mine. And the baby that they want you to carry is mine.
There's no comprehension to what is going on right here between, you know, Gina's best friend, the relationship between Eva and Nikki.
The lady in Maine did. She said she wanted a baby more than anything, but she lied. And I had to take her back.
The process of what she's doing is just, this is the sociopathic large. She's telling the story to herself of what she's been telling herself over the last hour. And she's given up on her relationship. And now, they're both giving up on the relationship, and they're both figuring out, how the hell am I going to get out of here? I mean, how am I going to move on with life after this type of a confession? But remember, once you confess, there's always an action.
You're sick. Maybe you need help.
No. I'm sorry, Linda.
Thank you. one of my favorite parts of the movie because nobody sees it coming and everybody jumps in the theater. Everybody was like, oh my God. And, you know, it, just an emotional beat that sets this movie apart and allows it to have breath and allows it to be dramatic. The two couple, very, very, very simple in their reaction and how the body was washed up with twine. We shot that at 7 o'clock at night, by the way. So it really looks like it's early in the morning, but it was actually dark. And here, this is it. This is the moment that the movie completely takes you into the next gear once again. It's months later. She's 4 months pregnant. She has her children. She's carrying her child. That's her child. It's an amazing moment. And how did she not get caught? Everybody, it took me a year to come up with this. And it happens right here when Gina says what she's about to say.
Here's what I still don't get. You spend a year searching for the perfect donor, and you find someone that's anonymous and perfect, but when you start looking for a surrogate, you ask the runaway in your guest house.
Faye knows everything, and she's just not listening. She's telling the truth.
What are you talking about?
So obvious.
And she is a shrink.
Katie's been an incredible friend, and she has signed every single document we've put in front of her. I mean, she's been great. She nursed me through my miscarriage, and you know, she was really amazing to me when Linda got killed in that boating accident. Mm-hmm.
So right there is what justifies why she hasn't been caught yet. We've tried everything. We put up barricades, and we had police. We had an investigation. All was phony. It just looked like a bad television show. And so I just threw it away. I put that line in there, and Gina, knowing that she could do, you know, this role as good as she could, she just threw it away, and we moved on. Faye is just amazing. She's, you know, she worked on the character. She knew what she wanted to do with it. She always was ready to understand why the character was saying what it was supposed to say to Gina.
Will Katie have visitation rights?
And she was always right. And I couldn't have wanted or ask for a better actress to play Donna than Faye Dunaway. And, you know, again, let's not forget, she's an Academy Award-winning actor. Nick is an Academy Award-winning actor. You know, to have consummate professionals is beyond a gift, especially to somebody that admires the profession of acting. Most people or most directors, they don't really care about the actors or they don't know how to deal with the actors. I happen to love the actors. I love their choices. I love all the dysfunction about them, and I love all the things that they love about themselves, bringing the character alive. And that to me is why I'm a director, because I actually love that, and I'm very malleable in understanding what their needs are. As long as I understand the storyline, you have somebody that understands the actors, and you have somebody that can tell a great story. Everything else, you have department heads that will come to you with the ideas and the executions of what you want. A lot of improv in acting, if you allow it. Some directors allow it and some don't. I always allow a little bit of improv because I believe it gives you the ability to be malleable.
Let's go to the swing.
Oh, okay. Yay. Oh, they're your friends. Go play. How far along are you?
Oh, 4 months.
Boy or a girl? I do not know. I find out tomorrow.
So in Cincinnati, in this park and everything, we're back to here. So I went to the mayor's office and I asked the mayor's office, you know, if they would give me this hospital, which is coming up at the end, I would change the the landscape on camera to Cincinnati, because I fell in love with the city. I loved it. I loved shooting there. I loved I loved the people. It was just a great place to shoot, and I would go back there anytime. But all of this is courtesy of Cincinnati, and they were very, very welcoming to me in the things that were important to me. Man, look at the size of the house. Look how far out it goes down. It's just the depth of field. And here we are. Here's the hospital. It's Christ Hospital.
Patterson?
So this is my child, my eldest child, who's going to be singing the soundtrack at the end. There's Therese. She's 11. She was on Brothers and Sisters for 4 years. And, you know, I believe you keep it in the family. You try your hardest. If they're not any good, you know, you get rid of them, you know, like any other actor. But if they can do it, it's good to how you keep your family together. And, you know, sometimes they're right for the part and sometimes they're not. This movie just happened to be a perfect storm for all the things that I wanted, myself included.
Your baby.
It's not what I meant. Morgan?
Nikki and Gina were just fabulous together. They just always were. So, again, the perfect storm we can talk about. So here's James Van Patten. I've known him for a long time. Dick Van Patten, you know, famous Broadway actor. And I always thought he was a great character actor. You know, he was the lead character actor. And I just thought that he'd really do a really good job. And he did.
Looking good.
I'm sorry.
What do you mean you're sorry?
Well, the infection has spread to both ovaries.
She won't be able to donate again?
These are the last three eggs she'll ever produce.
So, again, we're going into the psychosis of Tara, which is Katie. And so the nurse or the doctor right next to her is the person that she blames. So going sterile at that moment made her crazy.
It's okay. Everything's okay.
You and the baby both did great. Great. And we'll have the results back in 10 to 14 days.
Yeah, we'll even know the sex, huh?
Look, I'm going to let you two be alone.
Again, going sterile at that moment was a little hard to take, and then do the flashback. And so Gina, you know, she's recovering drug addict herself. Per se.
She has been a nervous wreck all day long, and now she's experiencing more cramping, so I think we should give her something for the pain.
Really asking for herself at the end of the day, but she doesn't know if she's going to really use it or not.
Yeah. Yes, absolutely. I should write some for myself after that.
Little sense of humor. Jimmy improv'd that. I thought that was really good. You know, he's got great creative timing.
Okay. Stay calm.
Gotta keep her calm.
Yeah, keep her calm.
Thanks so much.
Of course.
Take care. See ya. I just think I'm going insane. I feel like I'm losing my mind or something.
But now it's all off your chest, right?
Yes. I guess. I mean, we talked about it all, and she had an answer for everything.
I mean, Gina's talking about Katie's reaction. And, you know, the red flags are going off all in her head, and she's starting to get paranoid. So this is the journey within herself to figure out what is really going on here. And Nick is just trying to be a supportive husband and really kind of be distant enough that he can live his own life. Guys live a different life than women. And when they're together, guys want to support and happy life, happy wife. I mean, that's what's really going on. Nikki is now painting that mural. Now remember, she was a student who basically was painting murals.
What's going on?
My favorite scene with the kids. I'm sorry, I have to break and say this. So she's painting this mural and the kids are just so cute here, and they work so hard at this scene. Look how effortless it is.
No, you're not sisters. You're just best friends.
Mommy said we're sisters.
I said like sisters, silly.
Come on, you guys ready?
Yeah.
All right, we gotta go. Big, 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 big day.
So, I mean, look at Maddie's character arc. You can see that she's now becoming part of the family. I've changed her clothes. She doesn't look so straggly. You know, Harlow is all the way, looks a certain way. And, you know, now we've got the identification of what is really going on. Gina's just like, what the hell is going on here? Okay. She just does not know what to do. And you see Matt, I love that little look right there, like somebody was there. And Gina's just boiling over at this point. She's just trying to figure out. Again, look, there's the artwork up at the top. One of the interesting things was that I wasn't allowed to light any of the fireplaces because the production didn't want the cost of that. So it was one of the things that I had to give up, but I always wanted a fireplace in all of the fire areas.
We went too dark, didn't we?
That's not your real color?
No, we started dyeing our hair after we left. Probably stopped dying.
You go back to slice of life if you look at Maddie and the way that she's eating and the way that she watches the conversation. I find it to be such a... You know, such an easy scene, but yet, if this went any other way, it would look phony and false. So I pride myself on the fact that, you know, I kind of gave this conversation a natural sling to it.
Yeah, but, you know, last time I was recovering from a life-threatening pregnancy.
And Nick kind of gets in the way of this conversation. He doesn't know what is going on. He just can't figure out, you know, who's telling the truth, what the truth is.
Well, for the first few weeks, we're hiring a night nurse, and then we're going to find someone more permanent.
You're okay with this?
Yeah, she's happiest when she's working, and I support it 100%.
You know, you guys... wouldn't have to hire anyone. I mean, I'm more than happy to postpone my trip.
Well, I just think it would be better all the way around if
a complete stranger raises your kids. Yeah, I can see that.
So we get a little bit of snarky here. She's starting to lose her positioning in the family. You know, first she was a friend, you know, a guest, and then a friend, and then, you know, kind of a nanny or babysitter. And then she's painting, which is what she did in college. And that's how this whole thing started. And that's how she's been able to live this lie, is she goes in and she finds a way in to paint murals. And she's psychotic enough that she's painting the same mural over and over. And with a little bit different twist. And she's starting to be discovered.
Where is this coming from? I thought you guys worked it out. All right.
Brian.
All right.
So Gina's starting to stress out, and her backstory's starting to come up, and, you know, she's questioning herself. She's questioning him. Is she sleeping with him? Are they sleeping together? And so she just needs a moment, and she goes and she reaches for those pills, you know, just a blast from the past. One Xanax, that's all I need. I'll calm down. And she realized, I'm not going to do it. My kids, my family's too important to me. And she's discovered at that moment, you know, perception is everything. We go to the next part where everybody's thinking about their life and their function inside this family. Who's sleeping with who, and what's important, and where are the kids, and remember, she's carrying her last child that she's sterile from. So she's sterile, and she's carrying her last baby. That's the miracle. That's the oxymoron of the movie. So this is Treese, my 11-year-old, singing this song right here. So it's, she sings this, and she co-sings at the end of the movie. You know, inside a monster. So I was proud that I was able to put that music, you know, in the box and use this Treese's song. We worked for 7 months on the song. So it just so happens, again, perfect storm that I got to use it and see where I could use it, where it actually fit. And this is a flashback. All the flashbacks, you know, the way that I wanted to do this was the flashbacks were red and black and dark and corners, you know, black corners. The Morgan's house was blues, riches, blues, grays, creamy, and then the hospital is bright white and gray. So we come in here, you know, love this scene. One of my favorite scenes of the movie. It was supposed to be shot the other way around, but they wouldn't turn that spigot. So, boy, did I fight with them, and they wouldn't turn it, so eventually I just gave in. And this scene was the longest scene of the entire film, besides the outside stuff that we saw with the wait. We went into overtime and deep into the morning because it was such a small space.
Who are you?
I gave you that child. You said you wanted nothing more in this world.
Where's Matt?
No, you lied!
She kills her, and she knocks her out. She's not dead, but she doesn't want to kill her. But now, as you can see, she's turning her head because she's really not a killer. She'd just do anything for her children. That's what the movie is about. Whether you're on the right side of it or the wrong side of it, you're always going to do what's right by what you think is right for your children. Just mother instinct. And I love that. It's a piece of artwork that I love. That's one of the shots that I love. I think it's just poetic. It's death, and really neither one is the mother. And she decides at that point to take the identity. And this is, I wanted this necklace. I found this necklace. I thought it represented everything that the movies were supposed to represent, the cherub. And then on the back, it says Maddie. But the birthday on it is really Sienna's birthday. It's a real birthday. So she puts it on. She assumes the identity of her mother at that point, whatever that means. I mean, but everything's changed now. Now she's made the commitment to kidnap that child. And she wakes up here, you know, thinking about Harlow and what she's going to do here at this moment in time. And that she knows that Gina is now really a drug addict or in her mind it is, and Gina's coming to figure out, oh, hey, it didn't really take anything. I thought about it, but I didn't do it. So they're checking each other out, and this is the beginning of the boiling point of, oh, my God, we really don't like each other at this point, and what are we going to do?
Listen, about last night, it's not what you think.
I know what I saw. You're a drug addict.
No, I'm not. Listen, after your amnio, I started panicking. You were freaking out. It made me really anxious.
Do you ask
to see the necklace around
drugs?
Her?
Yeah, well, I didn't take one.
Yeah, and you expect me to believe that.
It's the truth.
Neck. And if you look at their acting styles, they're so different, but they complement each other like a glove. I mean, this movie is a great movie in that the female audience is really, it's made for them. And few movies, you know, are modern and made for a female audience. It's not Victorian or 18th century. So I'm really proud of that. And I'm really proud of the actresses. Everybody gave it their all, and they really understood the movie that they were making, even with all our limitations. And everything has limitations. Nobody makes a movie and says, you know, oh, that's great. Everyone says, I want more. I want this. I want that. And, you know, for me, it was, do I get the basics of what I believe the movie needs to have? And then I'll work with inside that. And that's what I fought about for the entire movie was, you know, I'm the person who has to take the rise or the fall of my own mistakes. So I have to make sure that the baseline is correct. And so this house almost didn't happen. I had to get up at 6 o'clock in the morning and knock on the owner's door because there was not money in the budget. And, you know, when I told the owner how much we had, he's like, it doesn't even fuel up my, you know, my jet. But heart and passion count for a lot. And telling a story and involving people is how you make movies. And he graciously allowed me to come into his house. And I am forever grateful because I think it made it a great backdrop. As he moved to one side of the house, we would film on the other side. And hopefully he's proud of this. Hopefully they're proud of it. A little cat and mouse game here. You know, the movie slows down a little bit right here in terms of this, how do we make the cat and mouse happen? So there's Eli again. And then if you look at the top, it says 10, 3, 4. So 10 is my kid's birthday. So October, March, and April are my three children's birthdays. So I came up with that little tidbit on the postcard, which I thought, you know, it was interesting. So every time I got a chance to be creative, I wanted to be creative. I just didn't want to leave it to chance. You know, I thought the music was really important in this movie, so I fell in love with the temp score that I had put together. And so, you know, in doing that, I tried to go after people that I really wanted to work with, and they were busy, and then I asked them, and I waited, and they were still busy, so I changed it around. I hybrided some of the music from buying the rights and just recreating it to doing original music, and we got really lucky. The guy who did the music understood what I wanted, and you know, and really played to my feelings.
Pancakes.
Okay, what would you like on your pancakes?
Strawberries, blueberries, and grapes.
So this was almost her last scene. So you can see she's so comfortable with Katie, mommy. You know, and you can also see Katie recognizing that her OCD has kicked in, and really what is going on with her book being moved. I mean, it's a small space. Anybody would recognize things that are out of order, especially if you put them in order. So I could have gone a little bit over the top here. Again, I went less is more. As Katie is starting to dive into her sociopathic behavior, you see Gina doing the investigation. And they're basically climbing at the same time. And, you know, it's the cat and mouse game of how much do I let on? So, and Katie is letting her character out more and more, the truth. Because what happens when she lets out the truth? She does something horrific. So every single time you see the truth being revealed by her, she's coming into character of Tara. Tara has a dark hair.
What happened, baby?
My mom had to smell it. Oh, no, where does it hurt? Oh, there. Where else? There.
So at the park, we saw her say that she was her mother. Here, she says she's her mother. Gina's like, what the hell is going on around here? I'm over it. And she's at the boiling point after doing basic research. She doesn't know for sure, but she's pissed, and I think Katie knows that she's pissed. And right here is where it all comes together for her when she sees Linda, her best friend, and realizes that all of these pictures are covering her up. You've got to remember, we tried to make that that wall play a lot different storyline, but it was too much. We didn't have enough time, but I did a little bit. I mean, as you can see, everything's covered. Her whole face is covered, and Katie's face is covered. So, and Katie covered her so that she could take the identity of being her mother and that she would forget about her mother. That's why she's pushing her right here.
It's okay, baby. Mama's here.
Nothing. She's not your daughter. Are you okay? You're a little
ugly. You keep acting like she's yours.
Okay, that's just stupid.
Cat and mouse.
Come to think of it, when was the last time you ran her a bath, took her to school, or gave her breakfast?
I love her reaction.
Are you kidding me? I'm working. That's why I hired you. That's why I pay you. This is your job.
Yeah, to raise one of your kids and carry the other.
How fucking dare you?
Pinnacle moment.
You obviously feel guilty about it. Spying, snooping. Did you find what you were looking for when you...
Any mother or any surrogate is going to have chills at this moment in time.
You're supposed to be on your way to work.
Yeah, so are you.
Nick was supposed to come in with Faye at this point, okay. And he didn't because she had broken her foot. So I had to rearrange the scene. So there was a whole scene here with Faye, and she was part about it. So we just kind of rewrote it so that, you know, we go up to Faye. And again, you don't realize she's supposed to be, again, helping out, but she's sitting down reading. So she designed the room, and then... Now, if you watch the blocking, she's sitting in the chair. You wouldn't recognize that she's sitting in the chair unless I pointed it out to you. This is a very intense scene.
You picked out a name?
Picked out a name. Jeez, any woman would go crazy if people picked out their baby's name.
I think it's perfect.
I don't give a shit what you think.
Love that line. You know, here, the movie changes gears once again.
Talking a lot about how worried they are about you.
Oh, really? Have they? So I guess that you told them, didn't you?
I actually didn't.
I just love how Nikki played it down, how she just was still likable at the worst moments.
No, of course not. I'm upset because I caught her referring to herself as Cora's mother this morning.
Cora bumped her head. I was consoling her.
Yes, as her mother, which you are not.
Nick is just like, I don't know what to do here.
She said this straight to my face. I'm sorry. We don't know anything about this woman. We don't know what she's capable of.
He's not taking his wife's position. He's just worried about the baby at this point. You know, all he wants is a son. I mean, like anybody else, he's concerned about the big picture. Truth is being revealed.
You named it. You called it. That was her in the guest room that time, wasn't it?
What are you implying? Yes, and if you had asked me, I would have told you.
I did ask you. I asked you straight to your face, and you lied. Did you or did you not know that Linda was going to be her surrogate?
Angela, stop it.
Was Linda's death an accident? Or maybe you wanted to get rid of her and carry our baby?
Enough!
Tell me, answer me this question.
Please, can you
answer me this question?
Brian,
make her answer.
Please, can you just stop, please?
She's faking it. You knew it. You called it from day one. She's a liar. She's faking, don't you? Oh, my God.
I mean, this is when all the women in the audience really identify with what is going on. And the men are just going, wow. Okay, so Jimmy does a good job of, you know, coming over and being that doctor.
She's fine. They're both fine. But
great character actor. Great. I mean, he's done 28 movies. Comes from a famous family. Couldn't have asked for anything more. So there is the tree of life. So this is a recurring theme in different parts throughout the movie. And if you look at it, you know, she's just continually it. And then it's the piece that puts it together at the end in the flashback. So we use it in the internet. We use it in this room. We use the tree in Monica Wheeler's office. And why is it so important? Because Katie was painting this tree for Monica Wheeler when she said, listen, you're a college student. Come and work for me and make some more money. And she said, is it safe? She goes, yeah, I'll be with you the whole time. And then she becomes sterile. And that's why she holds Monica Wheeler responsible at the core, and it's what made her crazy.
prove it. I want a urine sample.
Really?
And then I want you to apologize to Katie. I don't care what you say, but you have to make this right.
It seems a little unrealistic that he's asking that and that she's reacting and she's having this moment. But at the end of the day, he doesn't know what else to do because he doesn't want Katie to run to a lawyer or separate the baby from the family. So he's just doing what he thinks is best. It probably isn't best, and it was an odd reaction. But you kind of get that feeling that you know, something had to be done. Nick also distanced himself at this point because he just doesn't know what to do. Again, look how beautiful that house looks, you know, with these long shots. And so she gets up and her child is in bed with Katie and the other child. Now, remember, that's Katie. She's carrying her last egg, and these are her two children. So the oxymoron of the movie is that type of a subject matter has never been broached before. It's never been talked about. So IVF, there is no movie about IVF. This is it. And so I'm really trying to bring in an audience where this has been in the back closets, you know, for a long time. The guest house is now locked because she doesn't trust the fact that Gina is not going to be snooping around. So we were supposed to break a glass and, you know, all the windows were too small. So we kind of found a way for her to find this open window. I love the guest house, and I really love shooting this house. This and the hospital. The hospital was unbelievable. Oh, God. I know it's fake and it hurts every time I see it. Jeez. So she's coming back for the picture, and, you know, a sociopath is just too smart for their own good. So, I mean, that's what's going on right now. She's looking for it, and she's bleeding, and she's thinking, why is my nanny or this stranger in bed with my daughter, and who is this person? Who is this person? And so, you know, she just keeps trying to figure it out. She knows something's wrong, and right here, we were supposed to shoot a scene where there was a reflection of Katie, and I thought it was cheesy in the script, so I pulled it out, and I didn't shoot it. But in the same breath, I'm giving away, you know, who Tara is and who Katie is. And this is the moment that the audience puts it all together. This is when Gina puts it all together and realizes that between the hair and the eyes, you know, and Maddie's hair color, that something's seriously wrong here. And you can see that she's mad, but she's got to pull it together. And so, I mean, she's doing what Nick asked her to do. She's sucking it up. Nobody realizes that the cut and what it represents right here. Kind of this is the truth of the movie. This is the underlining truth that Gina's talking about right now.
I'm really, truly sorry and profoundly embarrassed. I don't know, somehow seeing you like that, carrying my child, it's... I mean, they warn you about this. You know, they say the moment that it really hits you, I mean, my child is always going to be half Brian's and half someone else's. And for some reason with Cora, it was okay, even though it was someone else's DNA. At least I carried her. It was my womb. We had.
And that's the oxymoron of the movie. At least it was in my womb when she did Cora. Now Gabriel is in Katie's womb, and it's Katie's egg. So when you start playing with this in your head, that's the magic of Inconceivable. That's why it's called Inconceivable, because everything is just so inconceivable. It's not, you couldn't write a movie about this. But yet, We did write a movie and are doing the subject matter so that everybody who has gone through this or wants to go through it or has a nanny coming into their house or you know, wants to jeopardize their family or any, they're going to think twice about it, because hopefully I'm playing it as less is more. And, you know, it's just supposed to be kind of real, because it is real. This was the first scene of the movie, by the way. So here's the hospital, first scene, day one, right here, scene one. Everybody was fresh, and I tried to make it so they look like they're having an affair here.
Answered a question, either one of us.
Katie, if she were using, why would she have given the sample?
So there was a scene right after this where they actually give a hug and she drops the urine. But it looked phony to me, so I took it out and I ended the scene here. So as this is going on, where Gina is looking in her red box of adoption papers, you know, they're at the hospital doing the urine test and it drops. And so we don't continue that storyline, but it wasn't that important. Really, it's just the investigation. A lot of things drop off, you know, because they're red herrings. They're just not that important, but they have to tell the story that there's a dead end so that we can get here, which is another investigation that's actually going to bring you. This is Katie when she was a five-year-old. That's what she showed Mrs. Reynolds in the tub on her phone. And then there's the Tree of Life on the internet. So this is where it all started. This is when she realizes, oh my God, I'm scared for my life and my kid's life. There's the tree. And why is she doing the same thing over and over? Because that's what a crazy person does. They do the same thing over and over and they change it here and there. They're trying to get caught, but they're trying to camouflage getting caught by the truth. So they're just making truth stuff. But they're really good liars. I mean, that's at least what I found to be when I did my research.
Okay.
Amazing Possibilities.
Hi there. May I speak with Monica Wheeler, please?
I'm sorry. Miss Wheeler passed away, but maybe I can help you with something?
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that. When?
4 years ago now.
So she realizes right now the gig is up. She's caught her. She just doesn't know how to confirm it to herself. And she doesn't know what to do. She's scared to death. And I love this scene because I put her in Navy and I put it against the green walls. And it's a doctor's, it's his office, Brian's office. But it, as you can see, it's a very masculine wall. But yet she looks so beautiful here.
With a donor of yours a few years back.
Welcome back.
Yeah. And I know there's a strict policy of anonymity, but...
So she's putting it all together from upstairs. She went inside the children's room. She saw the tree. That's what brought her to the red box. And now down here to the website, and she sees it. She put it all together. She wants confirmation.
Sorry.
Yes, of course, I understand. Let me ask you another question. You know the mural in Monica's office? You know, the real beautiful one with the tree of life? I love it so. I was wondering, could you tell me the name of the artist?
I can't.
Why not?
The artist was one of our donors.
The audience's stomachs sink at this point. You can hear the sighs in the theater. And she doesn't know what to do. So, as a doctor, she puts something to... together and calls me. I remember I've known them for 10-12 years.
Long time no see.
Listen, I have a favor to ask. I need a DNA test. How fast can you do that?
It might take a moment, but I'll make the call.
Okay.
What a hair sample do?
Only if you get the root. Saliva's better.
I actually cut myself out of that because I didn't like my delivery, so I gave it to her in the headset. You know, you see me now towards the end of the movie. I was in the middle of the movie as well, but I don't think that I served the movie that well, so I did take myself out of it. We're going to put it in DVD extras, and hopefully You can go back in and see my conversation with Nick and Faye, you know, at the coffee table, which I thought was a fun scene because it was just me, Nick, and Faye. So at the same time, Katie now gets it. And she's like, okay, you know what? I put it together. All right, the gig is up on me. She knows this is going too far. So, you know, Katie has devised her own plan. Gina's devised her own plan. And this is the beginning of it about to unravel. So she went into the garbage. She fished out those pills. And she's got a plan, you know. The prescription was written and the pill was thrown away. And she's looking for DNA. And she's looking for to drug her. Funny thing is this is the last day with the kids. It was really, really late, and they were exhausted, and we had one more scene, and they were troopers. These kids, you know, when something is seamless, you don't realize that they're there. That's when you know somebody did an amazing job. They never overacted, and Sienna was a champ. Harlow was a champ, and I just take my hat off to them. They're 4 years old.
I'll clean up. It's okay.
Mm. Yep. I have to get ready.
Mm-hmm. Have fun.
So there's Gina. So all of this we worked out in the table read, you know, how many bags and what we were going to do and how, you know, where this basic staging was going to be. This, what saved the entire movie from kind of blowing up was the fact that I knew what her natural instincts were because of what she argued at the table read. So everybody had, and people don't change the colors of their stripes. They tell you who they are in the first 5 minutes and you believe them and you work within that. You don't try to say, well, they're not gonna give me what I want. Oh, okay, well.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh my God, you guys, that's so amazing.
Ready to go to zoo? Come on, let's do it.
Have a good time. Yeah. Give Mom a kiss.
Unless you're Meryl Streep, everybody comes with one set of acting techniques and they change it accordingly. You know, Meryl Streep and Daniel Day-Lewis, these are people that you don't recognize. I mean, I think I did a pretty good job. You know, I'm in a lot of different scenes with a lot of these actors and...
Hey, how are you?
Okay.
Busy morning?
It's very hard directing myself. I have to say, when you look at Woody Allen and Warren Beatty and Barbara Streisand, you see these people directing themselves. You have no idea because you have to block yourself.
Hey, we're gonna do lunch.
Set the scene. Make sure you know your lines. Make sure that you know where everybody is, and then you have to jump in the scene. You have to say action, and then you have to go back and watch it and make sure that you did what you needed your actors to do. So it was very, very difficult. I can't imagine doing an entire movie. Like, George Clooney does it all the time. And, I have a lot of respect for people that are doing both jobs because it takes an awful lot of brain power. So here are the drugs kicking in. She just feels tired. She doesn't really know that they're drugs yet. She drank everything. She had her lunch. She didn't want to have her lunch with me. And you know, wherever she's going, she could be going to an appointment. And she realizes that she can't keep her eyes open. So, again, great method actress. Really understood her character. Nick understood his character. I got really lucky when it came to the simplicity of this movie and yet the choices that everybody made, because they all made individual choices that were very interesting and they were all less is more. And I respected that so much because this movie could have gone the other way. the time it said it was, the date was September 6th. It was supposed to be October 6th because that's Teresa's birthday. Ah, she realizes something happened. I haven't drank anything else. She puts it together again. And guess what? She's hungover and it's hours later and she doesn't know what to do. She's going home. She's going home and she's going to, you know, figure out, take a shower and talk to Brian. You know, I'm out there doing the DNA right now. But intricate part of her investigation just landed on my desk. And, you know, little does everybody know that, you know, I'm the one that's going to put the DNA together. What am I doing? I'm showing that Maddie and Harlow are from the same DNA. So she's a little hungover. She doesn't know what's going on. And Brian never went to the zoo. He was doing a surprise party. I mean, that's what he was planning with the girls. The funny thing is the girls aren't in the scene because I was told to take them out because we didn't have time to shoot them. And I really wanted them in this scene. I thought it was a crime for them not to be here. But this scene is an amazing scene. Nick was amazing. I mean, Gina, all the improv on top of the scripts, the lines were unbelievable.
Special.
What are you doing?
She's trying to kill me.
I put all the extras there to make them feel uncomfortable, the scene to feel uncomfortable.
Spend the rest of your life in jail.
Tell them right now.
Stop.
She's Cora's biological mother and Gabriel's too.
Everybody's in a reaction state.
She's
trying to edge me out.
You are an addict.
Listen.
You are an addict.
Look at this picture.
Okay, all right.
That is her.
Okay,
that is her. You tell me
that's
her.
You're cheating on me because you cheated because you said we're going to take.
This is the most uncomfortable part of the whole movie. So she's about to throw up. Again, look at the artwork, which is, you know. And Katie knows that we've gotten to the end and this is it. She's like, oh my God, it's coming close to the end. So she takes control. She puts Brian, separates the two, knowing that she's in control for a second. And I love the music starting now. I love the guitar. And I love how Nikki, Katie, Tara outs herself at this moment. And Gina's going to stab her? Come on. And so she's just thinking, this is crazy. So she puts the knife down and now they're having the conversation. This is from now to the end of the movie, this is my favorite part of the film because it's just so gripping.
Are the families? Is Maddie even yours?
Oh, yes, she is. So is Cora. And Gabriel.
I mean, the audience is screaming right now.
I didn't do this for the money. I gave my eggs so my babies would be taken care of.
Everybody in the audience was just blown away.
It was to have a baby. You lied. You all lied. You sacrificed.
The true person coming out.
I sacrificed everything. Now I
the truth. The oxymoron. The insanity.
Oh, now come on, after that little performance out there.
That's why I love the title. Inconceivable. This is what's going on right now.
The truth will come out.
You just told all your friends. None of them believed you.
Yeah. Well, DNA doesn't lie.
I'd rather die than...
Oh, who does that? Who stabs himself? I mean, the insanity of the moment. Who does that? You know, and she did a great job looking her in the eye. And now she's setting her up because she told her the truth and she's going to kill her. But Brian gets there just in time. Watch what happens right now. She does stab her, but watch what I do with the color. The desaturation happens right now. See, you can see everything starting to blur, go towards black and white. Now to the end of the movie, everything has a different look to it. I've changed the way the lighting, I've changed the way that you kind of are interpreting the end of the movie. I mean, she's about to die. You know, it's 5 o'clock at night. I love the fact that now she comes by and she checks to see if she's alive, and she looks like a Rottweiler there. She sees Nikki's eyes and she's like, oh my God, this woman's crazy. And here I come. This is my biggest scene of the movie. Day one, scene two. And Nick shows up and he knows his character.
I just heard. How is she? I need you to see this.
And I'm about to give him the bad news. I took everything I had to keep up with him because he really understood what he wanted to do at the moment. And I was playing off of him. And one of the greatest moments is that Jimmy comes out. And I've known Jimmy for 20 years, 30 years. Here he comes, one of my best friends. And together, we're in the same scene. This is the truth of the movie. This is when everything's happening. And I just love her look. So the nurse here, her name is Amanda. She was schooling the kids. I mean, she worked with them for 3 months, Amanda Bullis. She was amazing. She knew what to do with them. She knew how to block them. She really did an amazing job. And she has a school, and now all the kids want to be trained by her because she did such a great job. Anyway.
No, would you please stay?
No, I have to go to Cora and to Maddie. Please.
I love this. Could you please just hold me? And he's so disgusted by this, but he knows he cannot do anything except just go along with it. I mean, if you ever thought that they were together before, you know they're not now, and you know that she's completely batshit crazy.
Will you ever forgive me?
You did what you had to do. Back in bed now.
He knew what he needed to do to give this scene what it is. He wants his baby. She wants her baby. And Angel is dead.
You and Gabriel are in good hands.
Stay with me the whole time. Please. I love you.
Katie, hi, it's Dr. Weissman. I want you to know everything's gonna be all right, okay?
We ready?
Yeah.
All right, then, let's do this. We're gonna count down.
This is, so, you know, she's now alone. She knows the gig is up. She's going under. She knows the baby's coming. And she wakes up and she's in a room. I made it very stark, very empty, so that you just felt like she's completely abandoned. Abandoned by herself, abandoned. The baby's not there anymore. And I wanted everybody to feel, again, silver, grays, and a very muted moment in life. I just love the way that they act together. They just have great chemistry.
What happened? Where is he?
There were complications.
Where's Gabriel?
He's okay, Katie. He's just being observed, that's all.
Take me to see him. Please!
Yes, of course. We'll take you to him now.
So they're kind of looking at her. So look at this beautiful hospital. So if you look at the left side, you see all the floor-to-ceiling walls. It was a classroom that I turned into a maternity ward. And it was just, you know, it's an unbelievable viewing area. My favorite shot of them talking together.
You okay?
I want to see my baby.
And really, you know, the end is that moment of I want my baby. And you know, he's just trying to make sure that she doesn't catch on to what's going on here.
He's beautiful.
Yes, he is. I want you to take a good look.
Yeah. Again, less is more.
You will.
She's looking up. And during this scene, this was the first day of shooting after lunch. And, you know, he comes in to get the baby. We only had, you know, the rest of them are all fakes. This baby, we had 15 minutes with. 15 minutes here and 15 minutes in a second. And she's looking at her baby. And this is what it's all about. Cora, Gabriel, these are her eggs. These are her children. And she comes in and she really doesn't know what to make out of what he said. But she can't get in because the magnetic door locks locked the door. And she, you know, I debated whether to really put blood. And I chose not to, but, you know, maybe I should have put a little blood. But then you realize, and there's the blur. I put that blur in there so you don't know. You don't know if it's a nurse. But now you realize that it's her. She comes into focus, and she's alive, and she's realizing what is going on. And she's thinking back about the picture of her with Cora and their happy family. And she's, the gig is up. She's lost her marbles. This is when she goes crazy. I just told her, go crazy. Start screaming. The nurses come. Everything's about to happen. There were words here. I turned it into a musical opera because I wanted the emotions to speak for itself. I love the fact that we feel her by the music. And she tilts her head right here. And that's when she goes crazy. Completely insane. And the cops come up, and there were voiceovers on the script, but I just had to mouth it. And we're watching her move into the demise of herself, Katie and Tara. And the eyes, basically, first you have the contacts, and then you don't have the contacts. And then the eyes are basically telling the story. And she's in a sane asylum. With the padded cell, you see the light coming in, and it's hitting her at the same time it's hitting him. So just at this moment, you feel that they're feeling the same thing from a different place. He has his family. He's saved everybody. His wife is alive, and he's vibrant, and she's, you know, now realizing that she lost everything. She lost their children. And, you know, in the script, there was no place for Maddie. You just assumed that she went someplace. I put her in the bed. I wanted everybody to realize that she, because of her DNA, you know, the courts gave her 6 months later to this family. And she, you know, she's where she rightfully belongs with her siblings. And that's her character arc. And it to me, it represents what the movie represents, family and trying to have a family and the struggle when you have it naturally, let alone artificially. And when you let people into your house, you know, whether it's a nanny or whether, you know, it's a permanent guest, you know, what type of havoc they can choose and what's underneath that and what love is. And how love describes this movie at the end of the day. I mean, now it's Angela's movie. It's really Maddie's movie because Maddie gets kidnapped at the beginning and now has a home. So this movie is really about Maddie. Then it's about Angela. But really, it's about Katie and her eggs and how they journeyed to this family. And I thank you for watching this film. So here's Monster. If you listen to this song, you'll realize that I chose this wisely. I thank Randall and George, my producing partners. Yes, I got to produce the movie. so don't turn your back. But if you look in the background, you can see the eyes. So all of these people are people that have helped with distribution, or they had something to do with the transfer of the script so that it got to be made. If you look at the eyes, they're changing in the background. Brandon, great cinematographer. We worked really well together. Nico, production designer. I mean, you saw her work. Richard, oh, I loved working with him. His editing was amazing. Tim and Anthony. Ryan, a pleasure. Pleasure. What a gentleman. Scott was a great line producer. Kevin Kiner, unbelievable. Very sympathetic. Ashley listened to everything and all the music in here we did together. Bonnie and I, the clothing and the wardrobe. Michelle, long-term friend, working with me for years. Gina, thank you, was amazing. Faye, I take my hat off to you. I love your body of work. Nick, thank you for teaching me. Thank you for supporting the women. Inconceivable. What a name. What a name. Gotta listen to the song because the song is so telling to this. Nikki, thank you so much. And Natalie, you did a great job. Thank you for letting me be in my own movie. James, great character actor. Sienna So Baker, take my hat off to you. Harlow, thank you so much. Pass the test, I'm still a monster. I can take much more. Yep. Emmett Furla. And then Baker Entertainment Group. So, yep, that was my company. Well, I hope you liked it. So, at the end, you can see the blackness. So I did this a little differently. I put the cards up and put all of the actors' names on the right-hand side. And just to kind of be a little different, I wanted to tell the cards through the department heads, the producers, the actors, camera, you know. I thought this was a unique way to kind of tell the story at the end. And for people that don't know what people do, now you know lighting, and then you can look and see key gripped is lighting. I mean, most people wouldn't know that. I want to say to anybody out there, if you want to see the making of this movie, there's a movie called Becoming Iconic. And it's a documentary out there that they did of me that you can just go to becomingiconic.com and you can find it. Really fun to watch all the people that made this movie come together. And the support staff. So at the very end here, I give a tribute to Warren Beatty, because if it wasn't for him, I wouldn't be a director. I was a writer and a producer. And he said, Jonathan, if you don't direct, you're going to regret it the rest of your life. You're a great storyteller. And, he changed my life forever. So, I really thought about, my journey with him. You know, Warren's an Academy Award winning twice winner. There's Storm by Therese. A lot of people to make a movie. So this movie cost $10 million. And, there's just a lot going on. So as you see here, we get to the end. Watch. Here we go. So it says, filmmaker wish to thank, and then I thank Warren. So, I found that I wanted him to know, thank you. And then it says from me. So, you know, when he gets to the end of the movie, you know, a little tribute there. And, JonathanBaker.com. If you want to know more about me or Becoming Iconic or my next film, thank you for sitting with me. And my emails are always open. Anybody has any questions? So here's the logo that was supposed to go at the beginning of the film. That's the brand of Jonathan Baker and the company of Baker Entertainment Group. And I got that from Samuel Goldwyn Mayer. Hopefully you're at home and you had just as much fun watching this as I did talking to you about it. Thank you so much.